आशुतोष जी नमस्कार, वेलकम।
नमस्कार रवि जी, थैंक यू,
थैंक्स फॉर जॉइनिंग। शशि विक्रांत जी नमस्कार, थैंक्स फॉर जॉइनिंग अस।
नमस्कार।
सो वी विल स्टार्ट द सेशन सून, जस्ट गिव अस अ मिनट। Karthik, if you can take over the session, please.
Yes. Welcome everybody. I welcome the audience in yet another very important session of Governance Leadership Summit by ELITS, a 2 days conclave, and thousands of people are watching it from yesterday and today also. Thousands of people are watching Governance Leadership Summit, majorly from the stakeholders from government and industry sector are the audience watching on 3D virtual platform of ELITS Techno Media, which is Avatar. And as I said, that a lot of industry people are the audience of this summit, and so this session becomes quite more important and very important in terms of for the reference of industry people who wants to get insights of how industries are getting promoted in various states of India. And this session will give a great idea about that. And as the name suggests, realigning industry strategy in post-COVID world, building global competitiveness. Government of India and also every state at its own powers, trying its best to promote their state, make their state more investment friendly. So everybody is selling a good story of their state, not only to the national stakeholders but to the global stakeholders. And we are very happy here to have representatives from the states which are actually internationally doing really good. Whether you talk about Kerala, Rajasthan, or Assam, and we have leaders from these states today here. So I would like to introduce, first of all, our panelists to the audience, the panelists who have joined us as of now. I would like to welcome Dr. K. Elangovan, Principal Secretary of Industries and Commerce Department, Government of Kerala, for joining this panel. I would like to welcome Mr. Ashutosh A.T. Pednekar, Secretary of Industries and MSME, MD of Rajasthan Industrial and Investment Development Corporation, and Commissioner of Delhi Industrial Corridor in Government of Rajasthan. And also, I would like to welcome here today National Director of Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises, Government of Haryana, here, Mr. Shashi Kant. He's here with us. So, three very important states have joined us here. So I would like to first request Dr. Ravi Gupta to welcome our panelists who will be talking about their states, industry development, investment development. Please welcome them, Dr. Ravi Gupta.
Thank you. It's an honor and a pleasure to welcome all our esteemed speakers at this important panel at the second day of the Governance Leadership Summit. As you are all aware that Ego Magazine and ELITS have been propagating innovation in governance for last 17 years through our magazine, through our online portals, and through our conferences. And this Governance Leadership Summit is a step in that direction to bring all the stakeholders virtually and create a platform where we create awareness about how several states are doing innovative practices in the industrial development of their respective states. So I welcome all our esteemed speakers and request Karthik to start the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ravi Gupta. So I will start by requesting for the initial remarks. So I'll request at least 15 to 20 minutes of initial remarks about the development of their states, all the panelists to talk about. And then we'll have some questions keep coming from audience, and there'll be some questions to ask. So I'll start with Mr. Ashutosh A.T. Pednekar, Secretary of Industries and MSME, and heading RICO and DMIC in Rajasthan. Mr. Pednekar, a lot of work is happening in Rajasthan. We keep seeing in newspapers, in various news, that Rajasthan keep on doing at times collaboration with industries, at times generating investment in the state and in various different sectors. So I would like to know from you that, because you are heading the department in the state, and you are also heading the corporation, which is totally in a revamping way, doing a lot of industrial investment development activities in the state. Would like to know from you what's going on in Rajasthan in terms of industrial and investment development.
Thank you, Karthik. First of all, let me thank you for having invited me, and I think you have chosen a very good topic of realigning the industrial strategy, especially in the post-COVID scenario that we are facing right now. See, we do acknowledge the fact that at this moment, there's a little bit of uncertainty in the minds of business and industry, and much of it also comes from what is going to happen about the third wave, etc. And so this is a time for all of us to sit and reflect as to what is to be done for the future. We basically have two courses which are open with us. We either can have a conservative and a consolidating mindset, or we can have an expansionist and a more aggressive kind of a mindset. And we were faced with this kind of a choice back last year in July, when we as an organization had to decide what we wanted to do. So we decided to be very aggressive, because that was a time to be supportive of industry, etc. And as a result of which, RICO, as an industrial development arm of the state, landed up doing having one of its best years in the last 52-year history of RICO, when we sold the largest number of plots and with the highest revenue in the last 52 years. So that really showed to us that there's a lot of appetite within the economy and the industry for growth. And that has kind of made us decide that this year also, we have to be more aggressive in giving various kinds of incentives and various policy decisions and interventions which are required to be made to encourage industry. So this year, what has been decided by the state government is to launch 147 new industrial areas in the next 3 years, and 68 industrial areas to be launched this year. And to put it in perspective, RICO or Rajasthan has 350 industrial areas. So we are talking of an addition of 147 more in that 350. And I think the idea is to carry industrialization way into the hinterland, reduce the barriers to entry for entrepreneurship, make it land more cost competitive, and in general ensure that first generation entrepreneurs and even those from the informal sector join the formal side of the economy. The other thing that we are doing is that we are concentrating on the big ticket projects like the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, the dedicated freight corridor, and the petroleum chemical and petrochemical investment region. Now, the DMIC is a very important project for us, and for which Rajasthan has now formed a new investment, a new corporation called RIDCO, which has a 49% stake from the Government of India, and that is currently under approval, and where the Government of India will invest up to 6,000 crore rupees in terms of equity towards this project. That is an important one. The dedicated freight corridor, already the movement has started on the tracks. So that gives us a connectivity towards the ports and to the hinterland. That is also very important for us. And the PCPIR, because oil and because Rajasthan is has the largest oil reserves, inland oil reserves in the entire country. So we are going to capitalize on that. And already a refinery is coming up, a $6 billion refinery is coming up. And next to that, we are setting up our investment region. We'll be launching our plots from next month onwards. We have been working throughout the COVID period, and our contractors and engineers did an excellent job towards that. Now, we also have something called the RIPS policy, the Rajasthan Investment Promotion Scheme policy, where we have a lot of incentives which are being given. Currently, it's acknowledged as one of the most incentivized schemes in the country. And the result of that has been that from March 2020 to March 2021, we have attracted about 14,000 crore rupees of investment in just 1 year in this entire COVID period. We are also concentrating on renewable energy in a very big way. And we have signed MOUs of 1,64,000 crores with just 5 companies. So we have major investment which is coming in that area. And that is also very important for us. We are also thinking that Rajasthan is very strong in terms of connectivity and logistics. Sorry. And we are going to leverage the presence of the dedicated freight corridor as well as the two new expressways, the Delhi-Vadodara Expressway and the Amritsar-Jamnagar Highway, which are, and what we are doing is that we are setting up industrial areas right in the vicinity of these expressways to give a further boost to the economy of Rajasthan. We have also identified a sectoral development. We have identified 14 sectors on which we are concentrating. These are the sectors of traditional strength of Rajasthan, as well as those that we see are having a huge amount of future scope in terms of expansion and growth, and where we are launching specific policies for these particular sectors. And lastly, what I would like to say is that we are concentrating on exports in a very big way. Currently, Rajasthan accounts for less than 3% of the entire country's exports. But what is happening is that it's growing at a very rapid pace. In fact, this year, in this COVID months and year, we had a 4% growth, and we did better than the national average in terms of exports. And we think that this year we are targeting a 25% growth in the exports of the country of the state. And we have prepared a specialized strategy for this. And we are pretty confident that we should be able to achieve this, considering the kind of growth that we have seen in many sectors of our economy. So in general, this is what the state of Rajasthan is targeting. We have targeted specific points we have set parameters that we would like to achieve. But this is the whole thing as far as the post-COVID industrial growth strategy of the state of Rajasthan is concerned.
Right, Mr. Petnekar, I think the questions for you have already started coming in from our audience, and there are a lot of things we need to ask from you. We'll come back to you surely. Before that, I would like to request Dr. K. Elangovan, who is Principal Secretary of Industries and Commerce in Kerala Government. Sir, personally, I have been following you from last 7 years. I think when you were Health Secretary, I had interviewed you in Kerala, and that time also there were exemplary innovations you had taken in Health Department, and I'm sure the same is happening in industries. But we all know that Kerala is one of the largest import-export states of India. And a lot of international business takes place in Kerala. So in terms of industry and commerce, a very important and unique state in the country. I would like to know from you what's going on in the industries and investment space in Kerala, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Karthik. And at the outset, let me thank the organizers, that is Elets Techno Media and eGov Magazine, for taking this effort to bring in all the state perspectives and distill those informations into useful information for the industry, so that all our industry friends are on the same page. I'm really happy and thankful for this opportunity. So I would like to make my remarks like this. When you think of Kerala, everyone thinks it's a beautiful place to go and do a holiday. This has been the overwhelming image of Kerala in the past, that this is a tourist destination and God's own country. Let me confess, the recent past, this image is also having multifarious dimensions now. Kerala is now emerging as one of the most preferred destinations for knowledge-based industries in the country. This is the fact that is endorsed by the international investors, not necessarily the Malayalis overseas, but by native Japanese and the Koreans. India is now, Kerala is now becoming a place where everyone is looking up to. But let me start off by saying this. Today's context is so relevant that how do we actually handle the situation, handle the industries, and then provide a path for progress? I don't know whether this is one happened just now or there. Last 3 years, we have been on a total different trajectory. Kerala has distinguished himself in the social bubble, social sectors. We have been number one leader in SDGs, even the latest ranking by Niti Aayog, we are number one. But there is a point, whether the social advantage or advantages in the social sector, as it translated into economic advantage, there we find a disconnectedness. This is the basic fundamental issues we try to address now. Why is that? Whatever we achieved in social sector is not getting translated into economic advantage. That is where we thought there are three major bottlenecks in the state, rather a perceived bottleneck in the state. That is why people migrate outside Kerala. Number one, we need to have an industrial infrastructure for investors to come and invest. That's the first and the foremost. Number two, we need to have an industrial licensing policies and practices that is time-bound, transparent, and very hassle-free. So the process of changing the industrial licensing was overdue. And number three, which is the most important and subtle thing which not many people have understood, is that Kerala has got such a huge resources. What is required is the state was to gather those information and put it up as a project profiles before the investors. Because investors wanting to come, but then information in the state is scattered all around. So the third important strategic business intervention what we did was gather all sector specific informations, put them in one place and understand where are our strengths. Those three things we have done in the last 4 years, and it has given us a huge dividends. First, industrial parks. We have taken it upon ourselves to develop industrial parks after knowing pretty well that an individual entrepreneur going and buying a piece of land, securing the clearances from all the statutory bodies will take long time. So the state entity called KINFRA, which is a statutory organization, acquires land and convert these lands into industrial parks with all basic infrastructures like common infrastructures, CETPs, power, water, drainage. I'm very happy to tell you that as on today, Kerala has got 125 well-developed industrial parks. It is like a safe haven for investors to come and start operating. We also have a plug-and-play model where people are basically very small in nature. We have standard design factories built across the state, giving space on rent. You'll be surprised to know that the rents is 15 to 20 rupees per square feet. So first is industrial infrastructure has been built across the state. The second, which is very, very important, industrial licensing policies. We have enacted three legislations in the past 3 years to bring in so many changes. Now, the changes, one act that has remotely or respectively amended 7 erstwhile act is an omnibus legislation called Kerala Investment Facilitation Act, that is 2018. It has brought in three dimensions. One, the entire entrepreneur government interface is put on the e-platform. Two, it has brought a lot of transparencies. People could track where the requests are. And three, there was a time dimension. If within 30 days, if he doesn't get the license from the department, it is said to be a deemed license, which has got all the power of a regular license. So by introducing those three important dimensions, the landscape of industrial licensing has completely changed. As yet, this is not sufficient. What we have done is we have enacted another act called MSME Facilitation Act 2019, which basically says that we will give an automated approval for a go-ahead. We found all the industries have a problem of initiating their exercise, for example, building permits, etc., or even NOC from planning board or environment board, etc. So what did this MSME Facilitation Act says? You go before the computer, register in the 6 or 7 clicks, you get a certificate called acknowledgement certificate, which basically asks you to go ahead. Within 3 years of time, you need to take regular licenses. That means you are basically circumventing the process of taking building permits, building rules approvals, NOC from Pollution Control Board. But this act says any investment that is MSME and not falling under the red category of Pollution Control Board only will be allowed. Any industry, notwithstanding its investment potential, but falling under red category will not come under automated approval. Then I am very happy to say that in 18 months, despite being in COVID period, we got around 11,000 approvals issued automatically by the system, the MSME worker, MSME institutes. This is a paradigm shift. Because today there is no physical touch point. Nobody need to come to the government office. So therefore, while we are doing this, the regular licensing system is now being handled by another online portal called CaseShift. CaseShift stands for Kerala Single Window Interface for Fast and Transparent Clearances. This is what I said about 30 days time. You apply online, 30 days you don't get it, the system will print out a deemed license to you. It has invigorated all the departments. It has put in a lot of accountability in the system. All department offices who are so long by saying that we'll issue, have no choice but to issue now within the 30 days of stipulated time. By amending so many acts, we increase the license period from 1 year to 5 years. He said, no question of issuing any stop memos for a project by the panchayat. They're abolished. So therefore, about 27 reforms in three legislation has brought in a sea change in the way Kerala today sees investors. The third important strategic investment in the intervention has been to basically line up our investment strategies with the resources available in the state. We are not opening up every industry to come and do a business here. Certainly, we cannot give land to the extent of 100 or 200 acres. We don't want a coal thermal plant. We cannot afford to have this because people are highly conscious about the environment issues here. So what is that we should look for? That is where we are looking for. We have made a strategic decision to attract investments in 7 core areas. 1, Kerala is known as one of the health capital of this country. The way we managed our health indices, the way we managed the COVID in the initial part, although we actually caught up with a huge infection later on, but still the mortality is one of the lowest in the country. Kerala has been known as a health capital. So we have now attracted investment from health sector. At 236 acre of land, a park is being developed only for health sciences. This is going to house all medical devices, all sort of pharma companies, research labs, virology institute, and advanced sciences in science and technology, epidemiology. So it's a mix of both academic institutions and commercial organizations. We already sold about 48% of the land in this 236 acres. This is one thing that's going to really tell about Kerala. We wanted to start a generic pharma park in this thing. So the first pillar of attracting investment of Kerala is life sciences. The second is regarding petrochemical complex. We are one of the largest refinery under public sector undertaking in India. No one knew this. Kochi refinery is the largest refinery under public sector. This refinery is leaving a feedstock that is being now sold all over the country. We are developing a petrochemical park of 471 acres, of which 170 acres has been taken over by BPCL itself. So this is going to be a downstream products. The reason is that this needs highly technical people. We need to have some sort of feedstock which is available. The third important strategic area is food processing. Kerala is known for fruits, spices, seafood, and several cereals. So we have developed 2 mega food park, one dedicated for seafood and other for the fruits and cereals. Both are now fully developed, and a huge amount of linkages, backward linkages, the farmers group has been established. They are now in the process of making a forward linkage for exports. In a matter of time, I think Kerala will have a huge scope of food processing industries in the state. And the fourth is an area where we need, or rather we attract industry, defense production. Defense productions has been now totally, it has been liberalized. That is, minor firearms are 100% FDI. We developed 68 acres of land in Palakkad only for defense park. We started getting inquiries, we started allotting the people. This is a high-tech industry where people of particular skill only can work. That is to match the huge HR skills in the state. And the fourth And the fifth one is basically aviation. The Kannur International Airport is going to develop a huge maintenance office, the MRO, in Kannur, because aviation related all activities are going to be in the northern Kerala. And the sixth one is in light engineering, which is basically, again, basically a backward linkage of so many central PSUs. The last one is regarding the last one is regarding electronic manufacturing. Okay. Now, we are also in the process of developing four logistic parks. We have just finalized the state logistic plan. In order to boost up the trade, we have constituted a what is known as commerce mission. A commerce mission is a new concept wherein industry and the government sits together and settles all the disputes, the import-export related issues, all with the GST commissioners. We're all sitting in one forum. The industry is represented by all industry associations like CII, FICCI, Kerala Small Scale Industry Associations, and other chambers of commerce. This one forum has given so much of impetus into the way things has to be handled, and we are learning a lot in this commerce mission. Last but not the least is, we have been given an approval for Kochi-Coimbatore Industrial Corridor, which is basically part of Chennai-Bengaluru Corridor. We are now actually acquiring about 2,000 acres of land in Palakkad. 2,000 for Kerala standards is very high, please understand, in four parcels. And one about 500 acres in Ernakulam for a gift city. Gift city is basically a financial district. We don't want to have manufacturing activity in Ernakulam. We wanted all industrial activities to be restricted to the peripheral districts. In Ernakulam, we'll have a gift. So it's basically this. And more than that, the last point is, we have a huge return of the non-resident Indians, non-resident Keralites from the Middle East in the COVID. So we have been trying to form a huge program for them to reintegrate them into the state domestic industries. They've been successful partially, but the process is basically ongoing. Now, many of them wants to re-migrate into different markets. So we are doing a huge exercise of skilling and reskilling for them to send them to new markets. And we're also integrating them in the domestic sector. So therefore, just to make, if I can summarize what is what, the State Planning Board has released an economic review report, which said, not this year, the year before this year, that is pre-COVID time, we have posted 11.2% manufacturing growth, a double-digit growth in manufacturing, when all the major states were in single digit, has been a single indicator that Kerala has really actually caught up with manufacturing, number one. Number two, 48% of MSMEs in Kerala today are all established in the last 4 years. And number three, the total investment that has seem to have flown into this state is close to 32,000 crore, which is an all-time high. And these are all micro, medium, and small enterprises. Therefore, gentlemen, leadership at the time of crisis means that we need to develop strategy. We need to infuse technology in such a way that we have minimum governance, rather we have minimum presence, or we control them minimum. That is, the way the government handles the entrepreneurs has to have a sea change. There should be no physical touch points. There should be least points of contacts. All routine things are put on automated route. Only those which is impinging on environment or other related issues alone need to be looked into by the government. Otherwise, it should be an autopilot mode, I think, for which we are crossed a distance and much more to cross. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Willing for questions.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, Dr. K. Landhavan. And we'll be having questions for you. We have started getting audience questions for on your remarks. But before that, we will request Mr. Shashikant, Additional Director for MSMEs in Government of Haryana, to please give your initial remarks.
Good afternoon, Ral. It's a great opportunity to join this platform today. Haryana is a closest city to our capital, or it's a great opportunity to for new industries or new startups, we are providing here a lot. In Haryana, there are a lot of sectors: automobiles, textiles, defense, aerospace, pharmaceuticals, chemical, or energy. Energy related, large scale, cloud making, etc. So in this, we are working on cluster based system. We are making lot of clusters, 33 clusters in Haryana. During this making the clusters, we are upgradation QMCs, quality marking centers. We are making CFCs for upliftment of MSMEs. We are concentrated on a separate portal, HUM, Haryana Memorandum, Haryana Udham Memorandum. So in these HUM portal, we are collecting all industrial labor details. Those were working during COVID in Haryana, and we are facilitating all the laborers as well as industrialists by different policies or schemes. We have made two or three policies during this, for especially HEAP 2020, starting from January 2021. And food processing policy, and the third one is MSME 2019. So lot of schemes in these policies we are given to benefit to industries, or we are basically a new digitalization we are starting with. We are signed lot of MOUs with eBay, Power to SMEs, and Trade India, etc. And we are basically working on technology and quality upgradation. That's why we are forming more empowerment to the quality-based product, because we are concentrating on export business also. Right? So given benefits, we are given some schemes specially to exporters. A lot of benefits we are given.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Shashikant, for giving us an insight of Haryana's industrial development. Now I can
one most important. We have signed. We have made one aerospace and defense policy. That is a big achievement for us, because it's have a lot of potential on industrial ground. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shashikant. I think I should take some questions of audience, and there have questions coming in. Mr. Ashutosh Petnekar, sir, there is one question for you. There are a lot of schemes by Government of India also. There are a lot of Government of India projects also of industrial development. And your government and Government of Rajasthan also has various initiatives. So I would like to know from you that how you balance and make the synergy between Government of India and its projects and Government of Rajasthan and its projects. So how do you do that? If you just throw some light on that.
Yeah, that's a very important topic. First of all, there is something called the Micro and Small Enterprises Cluster Development Program. This is one of the programs that the Government of India gives a lot of incentives and grants for the development of infrastructure for MSME CDP projects. So we expressly concentrated on this for the last couple of years. And the result of that has been now that the state of Rajasthan has been receiving the highest grants in the entire country under MSA CDP for this project. Secondly, things like the petrochemicals, chemicals and petroleum investment region, the PCPIR, there is a Government of India policy for this. So although we have already started a development of the infrastructure next to the refinery, PCP under PCPIR, we get linkages and grants for linkages and an infrastructure which is outside the boundary of the PCPIR. So that is something that we're concentrating upon. The Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, as I was mentioning earlier, the 6,000 rupees that we are getting in terms of equity under the DMIC project is something that project was dormant for the last about 13 years. So that was reactivated because, again, that was in line with our policy to align ourselves with the Government of India focus areas. The same thing goes for renewable energy and other projects which the Government of India is focusing upon currently, like the textiles mission, bulk drug parks, medical devices parks. These kind of projects which are there, we have earmarked areas for the development of these industries. Now, the latest has been in the electric vehicles and EV component industry, for which, again, under FAME, we have now earmarked a particular location for the setting up the EV and EV component industry. So we do realize that aligning ourselves with the Government of India projects and policies is beneficial in terms of receiving a higher number of grants and SPVs and projects, etc. So we have been doing it in this way.
Right, right, Mr. Pendekar, thank you so much for this answer. Dr. K. Langhoven, I have one question from you from the that Kerala impacts and industry also. So what kind of support you are giving to industry and what is there in the policy to support industries post-COVID-19?
Yeah, it's a very relevant question. In fact, what we have, after COVID wave one, we had announced, probably we are one of the first state government announced a package for industries. It's called Vyavasaya Bhadrata package, which basically spoke about 3,000 crore package where close to 80% of it is under the bank finance and 20% was the state money, which is a significant contribution from the budget. Lots of people have actually benefited from this, in addition to what our Government of India has launched under the Atma Bharat, Nirbhar Bharat. Now, with COVID too, it has also affected us, and we also had a total lockdown for 46 days. Now we're relaxing. Now we are already in the process of designing a package, which basically says that wherever MSMEs or industrial houses have taken the rental or land from government agencies, they're going to waive the rental of these companies. They're going to accept a moratorium for repayment of loan taken from the state government enterprises like KSRDC or Kinfra or KFCs. Three, they're going to freeze the cost of land at the previous year's level for one more year. Four, we are going to give interest subvention scheme for those MSMEs who have really suffered from COVID up to extent of 5% of interest subsidy will be given. So we have around 21 incentives lined up for them. Very soon we are going to do this thing. This is to rehabilitate and relief measures. What is there for investors in Kerala is a very, very pertinent question. We have designed a program called Invest Kerala 2021. This has got 21 incentives again, 3 financial incentives and 19 non-financial incentives. I'll briefly touch upon the incentives. The incentives are, 1, the stamp duty has been reduced. Stamp duty registration of industrial land has been reduced. In respect of LPG gas, VAT has been reduced from 12 to 5%. And 3, the duty on electricity consumption has been reduced by 50%, from 10% to 5%. Now, these may look very small, but in reality, in huge actual term, in terms of absolute money, this is big. Now, the other incentives are that government is assuring wherever they want it that they will give a purchase preference up to 20% of the state government requirement. We have some companies approaching saying that, will you purchase us? Yes, we will not give price preference. That is given to exclusive to MSMEs. MSMEs in Kerala have got a price preference of 10% over and above the L1 rate. Please understand that. Certain items are restricted only for MSMEs in the state. I can quote, for instance, all the conductors used by electricity board, up to 19 strands. They're all exclusive domain of MSMEs in Kerala. Only more than 19 strands of conductors alone are going for open tender. So like this, we have inbuilt a lot of mechanisms, buyback arrangements, hassle-free issuance, some financial consideration. These apart, what we are doing is now any anchor investor who's coming to Kerala, we are going to sit across the table and devise the package on a mutual basis. This cannot be a one-size-fits-all. This will be a customized package for large-scale investors whom we call anchor investors. Anchor investor is one who brings in all vendors along with him for an entity. So that's how we are basically packaging, industrial packaging and investment incentives.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Ranguven. Mr. Ashutosh Pendekar, there is one question for you. Somebody has asked that naturally in Rajasthan there are oil reserve found and PCPIR project is going on in the Barmer region around there, and also renewable energy is one of the favorable state Rajasthan is in terms of renewable energy. So in these two areas, how are you trying to get maximum out of these two areas for the, you know, industry investment of the state?
In both these we face a natural advantage. The natural advantage in the renewable energy is in terms of solar as well as wind. In terms of solar, we have the highest installation in the entire country. So the very fact is that because of this, it becomes a natural choice for setting up for a renewable energy plant. The other thing is that we have a lot of land which is available, especially in the western part of Rajasthan. And it's a desert area, non-productive area. So both these combined give us a very big natural advantage when it comes to renewable energy. And we have made a concerted effort to reach out to various investors for this, large corporations which have been working in this, as well as things like pension funds abroad and investment agencies who also are investing in renewable energy in a big way. The result of which has been that we have seen in the last 1 year formal investment proposal of 1,65,000 crore rupees for this. There are also policy incentives which are also given in terms of land tax, reimbursement of SGST, of procurement of land by ensuring that there are no difficulties faced. So that has resulted in this kind of investment. The total in terms of production, we are talking about 30 gigawatts of production of solar energy. So which is a big quantum leap. And as far as the oil thing is concerned, we are basically talking of the refinery. We are talking of downstream value addition in terms of petrochemicals, which is happening here. As far as that is concerned, since the refinery is already there, the feedstock is there. So the natural advantage is actually in terms of locationing or positioning those industries at that particular location. So for which what we have done is we have developed the infrastructure already. RICO has already started doing that. And it's already on the verge of completion. And in July, we shall be launching the first plots. And the HPCL, HRRL, along with RICO, we have been doing joint marketing of this. In fact, this year itself, in the beginning of this year, we had an international global investors conference, which was chaired by the Honorable Chief Minister, which was attended by over 70 international companies. So that has been an international effort in terms of bringing investment there. We are talking of investment upwards of 60,000 crores in this particular area. And the good thing is that it is now linked very well in terms of railways, highways, two very big highway projects passing through this area. And water availability is also good because of the Indira Gandhi Canal, which passes nearby. So this is a major, I think it's one of the biggest new investment proposals of its kind anywhere in the country. And that is going to be a major game changer, especially for Western Rajasthan.
It's great to know that Rajasthan is making the most out of it. There is one question for you, Dr. Ilangovan. I just check that question. Yes. This question is about the person who was asked is also from food processing industry only. He's saying that you spoke about food parks. So what is the scope for food processing players in the Kerala? I think this person is from food processing sector only.
No, that's what I'm saying. No, see, we have developed a huge mega food park in Palakkad. I'm primarily for fruits and spices, and a huge mega food park coming in Alappi district for marine products. Now the land is available, about 15-20% land still available for them to come in. Once you come into the park, you have the facility of huge warehouse storaging facility, a cold chain. You have got a testing lab. You got a common infrastructure. You got all the facilities like ETP, water supply, power, etc., etc. Now, outside the park, what is that you have? Large number of micro and small enterprises in spices processing and food processing are already there in Kochi and in the Ernakulam districts, other districts as well. What we are going to do is that we are going to create a forward linkage for small time, small operators, and a backward linkage with this with the supplier of raw material. I strongly request the questionnaire and everyone to go and look at B2B portal. It's called Kerala E-Market. Kerala E-Market is a portal where we are basically linking supplier of raw materials to the manufacturers. Now this portal is going, this already we have 1,427 people registered on the portal. The transaction is taking place at around 400 to 500 people between them. We have not reached the full potential of transaction of all. But 1,427 has been registered in the portal now. Now, once you register in the portal, you will be able to see the supplier of raw materials in Kerala. We are linking up with all the farmers group. We are linking it with the Department of Agriculture. So that the farmers produce, the agricultural produce, availability is known to you. You can source them from the portal. One. Number two, we have decided now to make it a B2C as well. Once you are already done with the manufacturing, you can sell the product to the consumers. This B2C will take around 4 to 5 months. We are going to implement an open source network. We are talking to Nandan Nilekani's foundation already. They have agreed to give an open platform so that any platform, I mean, a person using any software, any platform can get into this online mode. You'll be able to either sell or buy the products. We are in advanced discussion with NSDL to give the switches. So Kerala is creating a open source.
कितने कुर्सियाँ गिन के आ
जाओ? Open source utility network. Okay, sorry. So an open source network to bring in all manufacturers as well as the consumer. So anybody who is involved in food processing, come another 3 to 4 months time, you'll be able to see on the net who is going to consume your product. Today, if you go into B2B portal called Kerala E-Market, you'll be able to see who is supplying the raw materials. So this kind of linkaging, backward linkage and forward linkage is possible today in Kerala, thanks to our department's initiatives. Hope I cleared my point.
Yes, sir. So I would like to ask you one question. Am I audible?
Yeah.
श्रीकांत, मैं आपसे जानना चाहूंगा कि एक क्वेश्चन है कि कोविड के बाद MSMEs को कैसे, how your department is supporting MSMEs post COVID?
Not audible, please.
जी,
your voice was not audible.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Post COVID, after COVID, MSMEs को support कैसे कर रहा है department? How department is supporting MSMEs?
We are giving lot of schemes. by the helping we are after COVID around 500 crores rupees we have given specially for medical medical equipments, any old industry or a new startup. We are giving 500 crores rupees, and we are we are providing fiscal incentives like Haryana COVID Emergency Credit Scheme, Haryana MSME Revival Interest Benefit Scheme, and we are promoting new startups for special provision. Or we are giving special provisions for new startups. We are after COVID. We are focusing on food processing industries. Na 15 projects of 195 crores rupees we have invested. Or backward forward linkage. We are working on that. Na food in the food process business. We are starting at rural areas, and we are working on backward forward linkage.
Right. So the person who has asked for food processing industry scope in Kerala, I would like to tell him that who is watching us here, that there is a good scope in Haryana also. If somebody wants to invest and want to see business opportunities in food processing industry. So here we'll be now taking closing remarks. I would like to take your closing remarks first, Dr. Landgovan, sort of summarizing the discussion, and how would you like to close this?
Yeah, my summarized view will be that we are living in a changing time. The changes are taking so rapid. It has actually changed the way business has to be conducted. So this kind of a discussions will only will give different perspectives. As I said, my own take on this is that governance in the times of such COVID-like situations has taught us several lessons. One, to have a minimum control on things on whom we have been exerting maximum control. To make everything online, so-called eliminate all physical touch points. If anybody can do business with you without coming to you to talk to you physically, I think we achieved a greater deal of success in handling situation like COVID. So no touch points, put everything on online, simplify the procedures, put on some automated route, all approvals and things, where it doesn't impinge on environment or other issues. You have to have, I call this word many of my talks, called masterly inactive. You have to be inactive, but it has to be a masterly inactive. You will have to intervene only at those critical points and critical places for to guide the industry, and at times to regulate the industries. Not only guiding all the time, there are offenders, of course. So to regulate as well. But the point is that this kind of situation has only taught us that time to develop a standardized operating procedure between the government and industry and put them on auto mode, so that everything happens as planned and decided. There should be no interferences and the governance on a day-to-day basis. That's how industry has to be given a free hand to do. Industry also should take up this as a matter of responsibility, the challenge, not to offend the laws of the land. Because governance now today is moving towards from the so-called questioning mode to a trust mode. Today, many approvals are given based on self-certification, third-party audits, and mere and giving affidavits. So the era of suspicion has given place now to era of trust. So industry should also now move into that responsible sphere to see that they don't offend any rules of the any acts, any rules. They don't infringe upon the environment or create a dangerous situation for the co-human. So it's a two-way business. Government will shrink its role, and industry will enlarge its role with an inbuilt accountability to everyone. This is how I see it.
Right, right. And sir, like I said earlier, that following you from the days when you were in health sector, and happy to see the same thing here, a systematic, innovative approach for industrial development in the state. And we hope that like this, in this way, there'll be more industrial innovations in God's own country. Great to know that. Mr. Ashutosh Petnekar, as far as I know, around 5-6 years, I'm following your work also. And one thing which I have realized, that whichever department you are in, you make it more professional. Unlike the common image of government departments, whichever department, I saw you in Jaipur Municipal Corporation, saw your work in Higher Education Department of Rajasthan. Now, from a long time, you are in RICO and Industry Department. So everywhere you increase the professionalism quotient of every department. So I would like to know your closing remarks, and would also like to ask you that how you make it possible. Anyone can easily notice whenever you are in any department, each and every employee, the environment, all becomes rather more professional than the earlier stage. Just would like to know from you and your closing remarks.
I would just like to second what Dr. K. Elangovan said. And he used a very nice phrase of masterly inactivity, where it is not required to be done, we should not be doing things. And where things are required to be done, we need to double down on those things. So I think that is what is important. And I think in every department which is concerned, if you look at the human resource in terms of their qualifications, in terms of their experience, in terms of what they have seen and what they are capable of, there's a huge amount of capacity in government departments. And we have seen it during this COVID pandemic, for example, in the industry of Rajasthan has very readily acknowledged that also, that when it comes to the crunch, government departments can deliver in a very big way. And as you rightly said, it's quite contrary to what is sometimes a generally held opinion. So I think that if one understands what the priorities are, and if the priorities are well laid out, and if the entire organization knows what those priorities are, then the performance really increases. And we have found this in the case of RICO, for example, where we asked a very simple question. We asked a question, what are we in the business of? We are in the business of ensuring that infrastructure development takes place. And then finally, that developed land and infrastructure has to be sold to a particular investor. So the crux is that our performance would be indicated to a great extent by how much we perform. So that is how we actually benchmark it. And I think generally, if we can quantify our results, although it is not so easy in the government sector, but if we can manage to quantify our results and our efforts, I think that can lead to great results for the organization as a whole. Thank you, Karthik, for saying some very nice words. I don't know how much they were deserved, but thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, sir. And it's my honor following both you officers from several years. On the basis of my analysis, I was saying these words. Mr. Shashikant, lastly, your closing remarks, please.
Like to say for in this situation we are promoting our industries by making a platform between laborer and labor, and we are also taking a step to by using some boards as like traders welfare board. We are promoting by insurance schemes. We are working on employment generation by mutual collaboration with CSIO, CSIR, and skill development departments, etc. So that's all. Thank you.
Right, Mr. Shashikant, great to know the good work happening in Haryana, MSMEs. Thank you so much. And here we close the session. Before that, we will just present certificates of appreciation and token of thanks from our side for sparing time. Dr. K. Elangovan, Principal Secretary of Industries and Commerce in Kerala. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing time for us. Mr. Ashutosh Petnekar, Secretary of Industries and MSME, MDVCO and DMIC, Commissioner of Rajasthan. Thank you so much, Mr. Petnekar, for being here with us. Mr. Shashikant, the Division Director of MSMEs Haryana. Thank you so much, Mr. Shashikant, for being here. So thank you. It was great, interesting panel discussion with some good questions and good, wonderful answers from you, panelists.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.